Welcome to the lunch for the conference on corporate crime and financial misdealing. And it is my great pleasure to introduce Dean Trevor Morrison, who joined us in 2003. As Dean, he has been at the forefront of a variety of new initiatives, including, and I think most importantly, the Program on Corporate Compliance and Enforcement, which he was really instrumental in helping to create and has been a major supporter of. Dean Morrison came to us from Columbia, where, among other things, he was co-chair of their program on law and national security. But prior to that, he's had a very distinguished career in public service, working in the White House as associate counsel to President Barack Obama. He clerked for Betty Fletcher on the Ninth Circuit and also for Ruth Bader Ginsburg on the Supreme Court, was a Bristow Fellow in the Department of Justice's Solicitor General's Office, and an attorney advisor to the Office of Legal Counsel. So it's my great pleasure to introduce Dean Morrison, to introduce Leslie Caldwell.
Thanks, Jennifer. Welcome, everyone. It's great to see all of you here. I'm sure this is a terrific event. I say I'm sure it is, as opposed to I can attest to it being, because the least good part of my job is that there are too many of these events when I can come in and spend 90 seconds introducing a distinguished speaker and then run off to the next thing. And this is certainly one where I wish I could press pause on my day and take all of this in. It happens also to be Admitted Students Day today, so I'm across the street retail politicking, bringing in the next class. And one of the big selling points is, in fact, that when students come here, they get to collaborate and work with faculty in terrific programs like this one. I think of this program on corporate compliance and enforcement as sort of part of the think tank arm of the law school. And your presence here and the terrific work you're all doing today is just a great example of the sort of thing that we prize doing around here. So my job is to welcome our special guest, Leslie Caldwell, the Assistant Attorney General for the Criminal Division in the Justice Department. The head of the Criminal Division, I don't need to tell all of you, is an incredibly important and big job. She oversees about 600 attorneys who investigate and prosecute federal crimes, develop criminal laws and law enforcement policy, and promote the rule of law abroad. She also works with the U.S. attorneys across the country in the investigation and prosecution of criminal matters in their districts. Leslie has a tremendously distinguished career. She served as director of the Justice Department's Enron Task Force, and for that won the Attorney General's Award for Exceptional Service. She's worked in the private sector too. Before coming to the Criminal Division, she was a partner at Morgan Lewis, where she was co-chair of the firm's Corporate Investigations and White Collar Practice Group. Earlier, she spent time serving in senior ranks of the U.S. Attorney's Office for the Northern District of California and also the Eastern District of New York. We are tremendously fortunate and grateful that Leslie is here with us today. So without further ado, please join me in welcoming Leslie Caldwell.
Thank you, Dean Morrison, for that very nice introduction, and thank you, Professor Arlen, for organizing this event and inviting me. I'm really happy to be here. And I really am honored to speak in front of an audience that's as sophisticated and knowledgeable as this one. And hopefully I'll say at least one or two things that you don't already know. I really want to focus my comments this afternoon on transparency and the Criminal Division's efforts to increase transparency in our corporate fraud prosecutions. Not just fraud, but corporate prosecutions generally. As the dean said, I've for about the past year, I've had the pleasure of leading the Criminal Division, which has 600 lawyers and is a really different animal than what some of you may be used to, which are the U.S. Attorney's offices. With the exception, the obvious exception, I should say, of the Southern District of New York and the Eastern District of New York, both of whom have a view that their venue is worldwide, most U.S. Attorney's offices pretty much stay within their geographic lanes. The Criminal Division really focuses on national cases, international cases. We're trying to do the bigger cases, the better cases, the more important cases, and we do them all over the country, and we also do them all over the world. And that's really been a big change in the Department of Justice since I last was there 10 years ago, is that a lot of crime is really spanning the globe now, and it's created all sorts of new challenges. Among the sections that I oversee are two sections that do probably the lion's share of the corporate fraud prosecutions that you see being done in the criminal division, and that's the fraud section and the asset forfeiture and money laundering section. And Washington being acronym heaven, I'm going to refer to that as AFMILS, so you'll know what I'm talking about. The fraud section really plays a unique role in the department's fight against corporate fraud. It really does a lot of sophisticated economic crime, complex securities fraud prosecutions, commodities fraud prosecutions, healthcare fraud prosecutions, and prosecutions under the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act. The FCPA prosecutions are really done, we often work with U.S. attorneys, but they're all exclusively done by somebody in the fraud section. The AFMIL section does also some very sophisticated cases involving money laundering, but also involving violations of the Bank Secrecy Act and U.S. sanctions law. And we've done some very significant cases in that space since I've been at the criminal division. AFMILS also has what I consider to be a pretty exciting new initiative, which is called the Kleptocracy Asset Recovery Initiative, where they really are civilly seizing and forfeiting money that's stolen by kleptocrats from their economies or taken through bribes that's then invested in the United States. And that's something that has only been up and running for 2 or 3 years, and it's had some really good early successes. One of my priorities at the criminal division has since the day I started, and it's partly born of my own experience in private practice, is to increase the transparency of our charging decisions in corporate cases. I know, again, both from being in the government and being in private practice, that in-house counsel and outside defense counsel often have real concerns about what they perceive to be a lack of transparency and how the department decides when to bring charges or when to bring some kind of a lesser resolution. I think there's also concern in companies and in the defense bar about what will happen to me if I reach out to the government and report something. So I want to talk a little bit about what we're thinking about in those areas today. Greater transparency really benefits everyone. It benefits the criminal division, because if we're perceived as more transparent, and if we in fact are more transparent, companies will know the benefits that they're likely to receive, and it will inform their decision making about whether they want to come in and meet with us, report something to us, or even if we find out about it before they tell us, do they want to cooperate with us, and to what degree. We think if we're more transparent, it'll make companies more likely to want to come in and provide us with information and cooperate. And on the other hand, companies can also better evaluate the consequences of what will happen if they choose not to come in, not to self-report, or not to cooperate with us beyond responding to subpoenas after we find out about a criminal violation. I think transparency also will help us reduce the perception and perhaps reality of disparity among the way different companies who appear to have engaged in similar misconduct are being treated. I think that's something that's important to address. I don't think the disparity is as great as the public perception of the disparity, but I think that it's still kind of on us to do a better job explaining why we do what we do. Unfortunately, there are often limits on what we can discuss publicly about our investigations and prosecutions, especially in investigations where we don't prosecute anyone, we don't bring charges. But we are trying to be more clear about our expectations for corporate cooperation, and the bases for the resolutions that we reach in corporate cases. One of the themes of today's day-long program has been the shaping of corporate culture. And we recognize that a corporate culture in the first instance is shaped from within. It's shaped by the company, it's shaped by tone at the top, and how that message is spread throughout the company. But shaping corporate culture through deterrence is an area where the criminal division does play a very important role. One important purpose of criminal prosecution of wrongdoers, corporate wrongdoers, is deterrence of future corporate wrongdoers. And I do think that there's a significant deterrent effect, because I know both from being in the government and when I was at my firm, companies pay close attention to what's happening to other companies who are in their same industry doing the same things they're doing. So I do think the deterrent effect is real. But I do think also that to achieve effective deterrence, we need to have greater transparency. We have to more transparently communicate our expectations about the consequences of corporate misconduct. I think that a lack of transparency weakens the deterrent effect and weakens the message that we send. We recognize that we can play a very productive role in influencing corporate conduct, and we take very seriously, and again, not to keep reminding you that I was in private practice, but I saw from the other side what a big deal it is for a company to be under criminal investigation and how seriously they take it and how seriously they take the consequences. So we get that in the criminal division. And I think that's something that I think we want to make sure that people understand that we realize the importance of. So during the first year, we've tried to make it as clear as possible what we in the criminal division expect from companies that do choose to cooperate. And again, companies do not have to cooperate. They have no obligation to cooperate with us. We think they should if they discover criminal wrongdoing, but they have no obligation. But we do have very specific expectations if they do decide to cooperate. And to put that simply, if a company wants to get cooperation credit, we expect that the company will conduct a thorough but tailored investigation internally. We expect that the company will turn over evidence of wrongdoing. We expect that that will happen in a timely way. We expect that that will happen in a complete way. And perhaps most critically, and we've really been emphasizing this point over the last year, is we really expect the company that's seeking full cooperation credit to identify the culpable individuals who were engaged in the criminal misconduct, even if they were senior executives. And we also expect the company to give us information and facts about what those people did. So if we have if they sent emails during the course of engaging in the criminal activity, we expect to see those emails. And as this sophisticated audience knows, there's not a one-size-fits-all internal investigation that would apply at every situation at every company. Effective investigations really have to be tailored to the unique circumstances of the company and whatever the wrongdoing is. But from our perspective, there are hallmarks of good internal investigations. Again, internal investigations that are being reported to us. And chief among them is the identification of wrongdoers and the provision of facts about the wrongdoing. And prosecuting corporate individual executives in the case of corporate misconduct is really our top priority in the criminal division. And companies that are seeking credit for cooperation really should keep that principle in mind when they investigate and when they report to us. I think there's been a bit of a misconception that the mere voluntary disclosure of misconduct followed by a corporate mea culpa is enough to get cooperation credit. It's not. If that's all you're going to do, you shouldn't come meet with us. You shouldn't call us, because that's well below what we expect if a company's really going to be cooperating. True cooperation, and I'll say it again, but it really does requiring the individuals who are actually responsible for the misconduct, whether they're executives or others, and providing all the relevant facts, all the available facts relating to that misconduct. Again, we're not seeking to invade attorney-client privilege, but we want to know what happened, who did it, and where's the evidence that shows those things. And in the meantime, you should know, and this is one thing that was a pleasant surprise to me when I got to the criminal division, because when I'd been at my firm, I had the impression the criminal division just sits around and waits, especially the fraud section in the FCPA case space, just sits around and waits for companies to come in and self-report, and then they'll work out some kind of a resolution. And I've been pleasantly surprised to learn that that is absolutely not the case. In fact, that's probably the minority of cases, even in the FCPA space, that are just started by a company coming in for a self-report. So the criminal division conducts its own investigations. It initiates its own investigations in all these fraud and asset forfeiture and money laundering cases. If you do come in and provide us with the results of your investigation, we will test that. It's sort of the variation on the trust but verify Sometimes we don't even trust, but we try to at least trust. But we will verify in every case. We'll kick the tires. We'll do our own investigation. We'll see whether what we find is consistent with what the company's been telling us. And we'll really consider the adequacy of the company's own investigation when we're deciding what resolution is appropriate in the case. Now, I want to make one thing clear, though. We're not going to tell you how to do your investigation or what you should do in your investigation. We're not going to dictate to you what the scope of your investigation should be, what questions you should ask, or things like that. If a company wants to conduct an internal investigation and seek cooperation credit, the company has to decide what's the best way to conduct the investigation. And although we can sometimes, if we have information, we can sometimes provide guidance to you about areas that might help you focus your investigation, the breadth and scope of your investigation is really the company's decision. All too often, and I used to be one of the chief critics when I was at my firm, the department's criticized for purportedly causing companies to spend excessive amounts of money, years and years, millions of dollars investigating potential violations that might just not even exist. That's particularly true, I find, in the FCPA context, where the need for international evidence can really add to the expense and the length of an investigation, and also to the burden on the company. And critics question, and I've heard a lot of my former clients say this, they question the wisdom of even disclosing misconduct and cooperating with the government in light of what they perceive to be the government's inevitable demand that the company conduct an unnecessarily costly, time-consuming, and widespread investigation. And in my view, these critics really wrongly blame the department for the length and expense of these investigations. There's no question that some cooperating companies spend huge amounts of money conducting internal investigations and looking into potential misconduct, looking into controls issues that led to the misconduct, perhaps doing a global inventory of the company's practices even when the criminal violation didn't occur, it was isolated in a particular area. When a company chooses to do that, that's the company's decision. When a company chooses to cooperate with us, the way the company approaches its investigation and its cooperation can have a very significant effect on the length of your investigation and our investigation. So let me just say one thing that I think is worth mentioning, because I've seen it a lot both on both sides of the fence, and that is we do expect internal investigations to be thorough. We expect them to be focused on the issues at hand and find the answers, find the misconduct, find the evidence. But we also expect them to be tailored. We don't expect companies to unnecessarily or needlessly boil the ocean in their investigations. And in fact, there have been several instances, even since I've been at the criminal division for less than a year, when we've seen some companies that, in our view, have conducted overly broad and needlessly costly investigations. In some cases, those needlessly costly, and I'm talking about hundreds of millions of dollars being spent on these investigations, have delayed our investigation, which is not in our interest, and have delayed the resolution of the case, which is not in the company's interest. And a lot of times these investigations include conduct that really would not be of interest to us, but yet were delayed in resolving the case, and the company is also delayed. A big problem may well warrant a big investigation. It probably does, and I'm not discouraging that. But the investigation really needs to be tailored to the issue at hand. So, for example, if there's an FCPA, if the company discovers a criminal FCPA violation in country A and has no reason to suspect that a similar violation is occurring in any other country, we would not necessarily expect the company to expand its investigation beyond country A. On the other hand, if the same people involved in the violation in country A were also working in countries B through Z, then we likely would expect somebody to take a look at countries B through Z. Now, this example is not intended, so don't quote it back to me, to suggest the proper scope of any investigation of any particular misconduct. My point really is that to receive cooperation credit, we just expect companies to conduct appropriately tailored investigations designed to root out misconduct, to do it in a timely and complete fashion, and to identify wrongdoers and provide us with all the available facts. To the extent the company decides to do something broader than that, such as a survey of its operations around the world, That decision and the attendant delay and cost from that decision are the result of the company's choices. They will not be the result of the department's demands. To assist cooperating companies in appropriately targeting their investigations to the extent possible, and again, a lot of times the companies find out about the problems before we know about them, other times it's the other way around, but to the extent we have information about a problem, we will help companies by sharing our areas of interest. I tell my prosecutors in the fraud section and other sections that where possible, if it won't compromise our investigation, and there are times when sharing information will compromise our investigation, so we can't share it. But if it won't compromise our investigation, the prosecutor should share information with a cooperating company to help that company focus its internal inquiry. And we really encourage an open dialogue between company counsel and the prosecutors about the progress of an internal investigation when a company is cooperating with us. Companies that truly have a commitment to cooperation, the kind of cooperation I'm talking about, will find that dialogue should be a very easy one. Now, as is their right, corporations may also choose not to cooperate with the government. I should remind everyone, though, that when you get a subpoena, you actually have to comply with it. And that's not considered cooperation. Some companies still don't know that. But a company that chooses not to cooperate really does have to understand the consequences or potential consequences of its decision. The lack of timely cooperation, for example, by BNP Paribas in an investigation into sanctions violations effectively frustrated our ability to prosecute individuals in that case. And the lack of timely and complete cooperation was really one of the tipping points that led to unprecedented charges and guilty plea and landmark monetary penalties against BNP Paribas. There was a similar result against Credit Suisse last summer in a tax case. BNP's failure to cooperate in the investigation was expressly referenced in the plea agreement, and it had to expressly admit when it pled guilty that it failed to cooperate. Not only that, but it had to pay the largest settlement ever, $9 billion. And that was just to the U.S. government. There were other regulators involved. And also, companies should realize that although a lack of cooperation can slow us down and can thwart us in ways like BNPP, where we weren't able to prosecute individuals, we'll still get there as to the company. For example, in a recently announced case involving Alstom, which is a French power and transportation company, the company opted not to cooperate with us for years. They didn't provide the results of any internal investigation. They eventually provided some information, but for several years they declined to cooperate with us. And the criminal division conducted an investigation. It took a while because we weren't getting cooperation from the company, but it resulted in four Alstom senior executives being charged with FCPA violations, three of whom have pled guilty. Alstom had a business consortium partner, a Japanese company called Marubeni. They were charged. They'd also refused to cooperate. They charged and they pleaded guilty. And Alstom eventually pleaded guilty as well and paid a $772 million fine, which was the largest fine ever in an FCPA case. These are all things that a company really has to consider in deciding whether it wants to cooperate with our criminal investigations. A company has to choose, as I said earlier, on its own, whether to conduct an internal investigation, whether to self-disclose to the government, and decide how much it will cooperate once it starts working with us. And for our part, as I said before, when we have facts and when we can share them without compromising our own investigation, we will provide you and companies, I know not everyone here, there are a lot of professors here who aren't going to be in this situation, but we will provide you with the information to the extent we can to help guide your investigation and for you to better inform your decision about the scope and breadth and issues that you should be looking at in your investigation. We also recognize that information about the reasons for our corporate decision-making about the resolutions of cases is also an important reference point for companies in deciding whether they want to cooperate, what they think is likely to happen to them if they do cooperate in light of certain misconduct. When I first got to the criminal division, I was wishing there was a way to make this some kind of a math formula. And I know companies are probably looking, there may be some professors here who could make it a math formula, but I was not able to do that. And I think a lot of people want some kind of a definitive matrix of if I do X, then what? And it just doesn't really work. We've tried that, and we are working to get greater transparency, but it's never going to be able to be boiled down to a math formula. Because while that might bring some level of certainty and consistency, it also would fail to include what I think is probably the most important thing, which is a really thoughtful and nuanced look at a very individualized fact situation and a very nuanced prosecutorial decision making. I think that's more important than absolute consistency and absolute certainty. For many years, as everyone in this room knows, the department has disclosed the factors that prosecutors must consider in weighing whether to bring a charge against a corporation. Those principles were originally written in the Holder memo more than two decades ago, when Eric Holder was the Deputy Attorney General. And the most recent version, which I'm sure everyone in this room is familiar with, is the Philip factors, the Philip memo, also known as the Principles of Federal Prosecution of Business Organizations. And that lists nine factors, which, don't worry, I'm not going to list them here, that we have to consider in deciding whether to bring a case against a corporation. And they're all important, and they're all considered. So. And I know you know what they are, so I'm not gonna belabor them. But those are things we really look at very closely to see whether it's appropriate to seek a guilty plea or an indictment. And I should say that I think you'll probably be seeing more indictments in the corporate space or more guilty pleas. Whether to seek a deferred prosecution agreement, whether to seek a non-prosecution agreement, or whether to offer a declination. And I can also say that I think you're going to be seeing more declinations in the corporate fraud space. Arriving at a corporate resolution in a criminal case really involves a real balancing that's unique to every company and unique to the facts. It doesn't take place in a prosecutorial vacuum. In pretty much every significant white-collar case and some not significant white-collar cases, we invite outside counsel for the company or inside counsel if they're handling the matter, to make a presentation to us on the Philip factors and how they should be considered in this particular case. And we take those presentations very seriously. I've been in criminal division for a year. I've seen us change our position based on those factors many times. So we do take them really seriously. excuse me, we really do encourage, not just when you come in to make your presentation, but along the way, a real open and transparent dialogue with us about the facts of your company and your company's situation, really at every stage. And then we also try to communicate our thought process and our analysis in the actual terms of our corporate resolution document. So whether it's a guilty plea with the plea agreement, whether it's a deferred prosecution agreement or a non-prosecution agreement, we provide a written explanation of the key facts and the factors that led to our decision in that case. And the factual statements that are generally publicly filed either with the court or on our website with the resolution documents usually will include a detailed recitation of the misconduct as the company is admitting it. And it will also outline the agreements themselves while outlining the factors that we considered in determining the type of resolution, such as how extensive and valuable was the company's cooperation. What were the missteps in the company's cooperation? By the way, if you decide at the beginning you don't want to cooperate, you can change your mind. We're not going to say it's all or nothing. You can come in after you have decided not to cooperate. And we see this a lot, actually, where a company hires one outside counsel who gives certain advice. They realize that might not have been the wisest course. And then they hire another law firm that gives different advice. So we're not saying that if you don't cooperate from the minute you hear about something, you're going to be lost for all time. That's absolutely not the case. And we understand that there are different issues with different kinds of companies and industries. I know from experience on both sides that a lot of foreign companies have different views about interacting with the government than American companies do, and we understand that. You should expect that in the future, our resolution documents will hopefully provide even more guidance to people who decide to come in and resolve a case with us and about our thinking and our reasoning. In addition, I think when you're deciding what kind of compliance things are good for your particular company or your client, you can look at our DPAs and our NPAs, many of which are public, almost all of which are public. to see what our expectations are when it comes to a corporate compliance program in a specific industry. Companies seeking to measure their own compliance programs really can look to our website and see the DPA and the NPA terms to see the kinds of things that are expected. And these are not things necessarily that the criminal prosecutors expect. These are things that compliance professionals would hope that a company would have. And those are all publicly available. They also, I think, DPAs and NPAs are very useful in the sense that for the individual company who's subjected to the agreement, they really do help the company get back on track and sharpen its focus on what it needs to fix going forward. And sometimes they'll be doing that under the watchful eye of a monitor or of a court. So there's really no more transparent guidance to a specific company than whatever is in their DPA or their NPA. And the DPAs and NPAs, there's not a track record in the criminal division or frankly in the U.S. Attorney's offices of declaring a company in breach of a DPA or an NPA and taking remedial measures. And I think that's been something that we've looked long and hard at. We think that those agreements have to have real teeth. When companies subject to an NPA or a DPA are required to cooperate and they don't, or where they engage in other criminal conduct during the course of their DPA and NPA, the criminal division won't hesitate to tear up those documents and file criminal charges, either based on the new conduct or the old conduct, which they will already have admitted to in a document that had been filed with the DPA or the NPA. In fact, I've instructed our prosecutors to do just that in cases where the breach is serious, and an action like that would be appropriate and proportional. Now, there are other remedies for breach besides tearing up the agreement and prosecuting. It's all very fact-specific, but that's something that we won't hesitate to do going forward if it's really appropriate in a particular case. Our role is not just to set guidelines for companies that have engaged in misconduct and hope that they adhere to them. It's to prosecute the companies when they ignore those guidelines. Just as with individuals, companies are expected to learn from their mistakes. So a company that's already been subject to a DPA or an NPA really shouldn't hope for the same leniency if it crosses the line again into criminal conduct. I found over the course of my career that it's often helpful to give concrete examples so that people understand what you're talking about. I'm not going to do that here. But we have done that already in the criminal division on our website and through our FCPA resource guide and other places. So we have a longstanding practice of not discussing non-public information on matters that are either under investigation or that we've declined to prosecute, and that is absolutely what the process should be, and that's how it's going to remain. We have serious respect for people's privacy, for people's reputations, for companies' reputations. We're not going to start disclosing things about, even if we decline something, we're not going to disclose why we declined a particular case, unless for some reason the company wants us to, which sometimes they do. But I think that most companies would prefer that the world not know, in the case of a declination, that they were under investigation by the Department of Justice. So we're not going to change that. But one challenge we're trying to address, because I said earlier that you'll see more declinations, and we don't want you to have to take my word for that. We want you to be able to see that there actually are more declinations. So one challenge that we're currently working to address is how to better inform the corporate community and the defense bar about corporate cases in which we have declined to prosecute. As I think companies and their counsel can often learn more from understanding why we didn't prosecute in a particular scenario than from understanding why we did. So we're working on that. As I said, the privacy and reputational concerns that we talked about earlier make that very challenging, but we're trying to do that. And after all, our goal is not just to prosecute companies. Our goal is to reward good corporate citizenship and to encourage good corporate citizenship. And increasing transparency, I think, will play an important role in achieving that goal. And I mentioned before one example of our effort to try to give you concrete examples of situations in which we've declined prosecution is the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act guide that was put out a few years ago, published jointly by the SEC and the Criminal Division. It has a section on declinations, and many of you probably have already read it and perhaps even wrote it. But it provides anonymized examples of real cases, real fact patterns where we declined to prosecute in the FCPA context. And although every case is based on its own unique facts and circumstances, those examples, I think, do provide some useful insight into circumstances where we declined to prosecute and fact patterns in which we declined to prosecute. We're continuing that effort by in the FCPA space by continuing the opinion letter process and by posting all of our enforcement actions on our website so that you can see the cases in which we are bringing actions and the type of actions we're bringing. We're also looking for ways to increase transparency around declinations in other contexts outside the FCPA. Frankly, the FCPA is actually a little bit easier than a large healthcare fraud case or a large corporate accounting fraud case. The accounting fraud part is probably easier because many of those companies have an obligation to disclose that they're under investigation for accounting, potential accounting irregularities, which I love when I see that word because I know that that means fraud and tell our fraud section to get all over it. But so those companies that have already disclosed an issue are probably happy for us to publicly decline and tell them so that they can put it in their filings, and we're happy to oblige that. And that the increased transparency on declinations I think is very important because I really want companies to understand that even in circumstances where their corporate employees or their agents clearly have violated the criminal law, not circumstances where there was no violation, but where there's been a real violation by their company, by their employees, by their agents, something that they would be responsible for legally, that timely self-reporting and complete cooperation can, and sometimes does, lead to a decision to decline prosecution of the company. And I think that that's something people should really be aware of, and I think it's extremely important. So through these steps that I've described today and other steps that we're taking, we have really prioritized increasing the transparency of our decision making, our charging decisions, and what will happen to a company if it comes in and tells us about the results of its internal investigation. We're working to figure out ways to disclose more information within the constraints under which we operate. And we encourage companies to be equally transparent with us. We view it as a two-way street. We're trying our best to walk the walk, and we hope companies will be doing the same. So I want to leave some time for questions. So I thank you again for inviting me to speak here today. It's been fun. And the last thing I want to say before taking questions is I would be remiss if I didn't say that conferences like this, I think, are also really important in helping increase the transparency of what the Justice Department expects and how we think and how we decide things. So thank you again for coming, and I'm happy to answer any questions, except questions about specific cases. Yes, sir.
You require people that are going, companies that are going to cooperate to name individual names. Aren't you worried that necessarily the bad actors will not be named, but certain people will be tracked individual lambs? And I guess what efforts do you make should verify that the individuals that have been laid out are in fact stopped with them
So that's something that we've actually seen over the years where people have been sacrificed and others have been shielded. And that's frankly what we're trying to prevent from happening in the future. We want companies to tell us all the facts about who all the people who were involved, whether it was the CEO or the sales guy in India. But as I said before, we're not going to just take your word for it when you tell us that these people weren't involved. Or I've heard people say, about, let's say, an FCPA violation in Indonesia. Did you talk to anyone above this person? Well, no, because there was no evidence. And that's not helpful. So we expect you to do, we're not going to tell you who you need to talk to, but we expect you to do a thorough, reasonable, tailored investigation and to share the facts with us. And if you don't do that, that's going to count against you. Yes, ma'am. I think it's more of a function of, so for example, BNPP and Credit Suisse, which Credit Suisse was a tax division case, but those were both guilty pleas. And when I say indictments, what I probably really mean, because the actual indictment of a corporation is fairly rare, but it would be the filing of an information and having the company plead guilty. I think that the department over the past few years has been a little bit cautious in charging companies. out of fear of collateral consequences. Collateral consequences is a very important thing to take into account, and we do. And if we think that the collateral consequences are real and serious, we think very long and hard about whether to do that case. But I think that I don't think the sky will fall, and it didn't fall after BNPP pled guilty. In fact, their stock went up. So I think that's one reason why we'll be seeing more actual charges and then more declinations. I think it's important to send the message to companies that there is an end to this investigation, and that the end could be a declination. You're not going to just have to wait for years while we wait for the results of our mutual legal assistance treaty requests in cases where it appears to us that even if we get that those documents from the Caribbean, they're not going to show who the account holder was in Russia. And we're trying to make more timely decisions about which cases are really worth pursuing and declining cases that we think just aren't going to be what we might have hoped they would have been at the outset. Yes, Professor.
Transparency is incredibly helpful. I was one of the apologists. On the other hand, you mentioned the 9-pill factor. If we're a publicly held firm with widespread wrongdoing and even issue collateral consequences, they start the game on both sides of the bill factors.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
They can get a plea, they can get an EPA and a monitor.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and so I was wondering, I see why you don't want a formula, although I don't think you love one. But
if you can come up with one, we're happy to look at it.
But I wonder about somewhat more, if you don't self-report and we find out you had evidence, we will convict you. And there are lots of ways to convict people without
Mm-hmm.
But we promise you we'll convict you as a way of just sending a signal. Here's where on the side of the street.
So I don't think we could tell people where they'll be because we don't know the facts well enough. But I think by showing through resolutions that we've already made why we came to rest in a particular place, companies can be informed about comparing their conduct with whatever the conduct was in that case. They can have some guesstimate of where they'll come out. And that's what we're trying to make a little more clear. Yes, sir.
In the FCPA context and several of the other two contexts in which your decision would work, as important as your decision might have been to the decision of the foreign agents,
mm-hmm.
I'm wondering if you can say anything at all about whether any of your counterparts overseas share your commitment to transparency.
So I don't know if they share the commitment to transparency. I don't know what their internal regimes are in terms of, I know they share a very strong commitment to anti-corruption enforcement in a lot of parts of the world, including parts of the world that you might not think. For example, in the Asst case, prosecutors in Indonesia prosecuted an Indonesian government official who's currently sitting in jail in Indonesia for bribes that he took in that case. We're working with an increasingly large and increasingly sophisticated number of enforcement agencies in countries all over the world. And so they certainly share a commitment to anti-corruption efforts. And I think it probably varies widely from country to country whether they're doing any of the kinds of things we're doing and trying to help guide companies about what our expectations are. Yes, sir. Well, first I want to say that I thought I escaped from Senator Grassley by coming to New York, but apparently not. I'm kidding. I don't want to comment on the specific facts of HSBC, which frankly I don't know. But I do know that collateral consequences are a very real thing for us to consider. And I don't know to the extent to which they were considered in that case. As I said, I don't know the facts. But certainly in BNP, we we were told by the French authorities, by the French president who spoke with our president, by the outside law firms and others, that if BNP were made to plead guilty, BNP would collapse. And the French economy, a rapid domino effect would take place with the French economy, the European economy, and the world economy, including the US economy. And we didn't take their word for it, but we also didn't ignore it. We checked that very, very heavily by talking with regulators who know much more than we do about things like capital ratios and ability to raise money and things that we were being told BNP would no longer be able to do. And at the end of the day, we didn't credit what they had been telling us. So, I don't know the HSBC facts, but I think if somebody has a at least facially credible argument of serious collateral consequences, we take that very seriously and we look at it very seriously. But we also are not going to be afraid to go forward when we don't believe that those collateral consequences are real. When I say we don't believe, based on informed people who know what they're talking about. I would have no idea how much capital a bank has to have on hand, but the Federal Reserve does. Yes, sir. Not necessarily. I don't think we expect, and I know my predecessor in this job said, the minute you hear about something, you better come tell us. We don't have that view. I think our view is we expect, if you find something that's a serious allegation of potential criminal wrongdoing, we expect you to look into it. We expect you to look into it quickly and thoroughly, as I said, in a tailored way. We don't expect you to pick up the phone and call us when you don't really even know what happened or whether it's even true. And maybe you'll find out that it's true, but it's so minor that we don't need to hear about, you know, the $5,000 payment to the Port Authority in Argentina to get one shipment in. That's not what we're talking about.
I guess I was asking, would you consider that to be protected by the Clinton Act program? That information, not the statement to the attorney, but the information that's in the statement,
is that something that you would view as privileged and therefore not subject to disclosure? I think I would need to know more about the facts, but I don't think necessarily we would think of that, of the employee reporting something to the in-house lawyer. It would depend on what the purpose of the reporting was and what action was taken after that. But we're not, to the extent people are concerned about us wanting privileged information, we do not want privileged information. We don't want your deliberations. We don't want your lawyer's advice. We just want the facts that you uncover in your investigation. Anyone else? Okay. Thank you.